from just one person.
And after 8 hours, 100 people have been affected. 16 hours later, 10,000 people. And 1 million after the first day. How many people by tomorrow? This is the story of the dress. And was it blue and black, or was it white and gold? This question was first posed by a Facebook user who was a family member of the person who owned the dress. There had been a disagreement about the colour of the dress, and later another user posted the photo on Tumblr, and the rest is history. With over 10 million tweets in the first week, this is an extreme case of going viral. So let's take a look at how the dress spreads through a population. The population is divided into three groups of people. People who haven't seen the dress, people who have seen and have started sharing the dress, and people who are no longer sharing the dress because they're sick of the dress and they never want to hear about it again. And people change groups over time. So how do the numbers in each of these groups change? Well, the people who haven't seen the dress reduce by the number of people who start sharing the dress. So they see it and they start sharing. And the more people that we have sharing, the more new sharers that we get. The people who are sharing the dress increase by the number of new sharers that we get, but they also decrease by the number of people who give up sharing. And the people who are no longer sharing the dress just keep increasing by the sharers who give up. And we can track what happens to the numbers of people sharing the dress over time. So here in a population of 10 million. So the number of people sharing the dress, it starts growing very slowly at first, but then it starts to take off. And once it does so very rapidly and reaches about 4 million people sharing at any one time after just a day and a half. And then the numbers fall away to nothing. And at the same time, the people who haven't seen the dress reduces slowly at first and then plummets as they start to become new sharers. And the number of people who are no longer sharing the dress rises really slowly at first and then it reaches its maximum. So why does the dress stop spreading? Has everybody in the population seen the dress? Well, no. By the time that the dress stops spreading, not everybody has seen it. The number of people who are no longer sharing the dress never quite reaches back up to our population of 10 million. It stops because the people that are sharing the dress can't find any new people to share it with. And so they lose interest before they get to pass it on to anybody else. And so the sharing numbers drop to zero. So this is a very simple picture of how the dress spreads in a population, and it ignores some realities, like not everyone has computer or internet access, and not everyone's interested in sharing memes, so even if they see it, they won't share it. And people have different numbers of virtual friends. So it's not an exact representation, it's a model, and it's based on a set of assumptions. So why should we even care about how a meme spreads through the internet? Well, it turns out that going viral has its origin in the term virus. So the way that a meme spreads through the internet shares many characteristics with the way that an infectious disease spreads through a real population. So diseases like Ebola or influenza, whooping cough or measles. Unfortunately, none of these diseases, or indeed any others known to man, spread anywhere near as quickly as the dress does through a population. So while it's very difficult to stop a meme such as the dress from spreading once it starts going, we've got an arsenal of weapons with which to fight infectious diseases. Vaccines, antibiotics, quarantine, just to name a few. And a very powerful weapon behind the scenes, mathematics. Using mathematics to study infectious diseases isn't new. A scientist called Daniel Bernoulli first used probability and statistics nearly 250 years ago to calculate the benefits of vaccination against smallpox. And the model that I use to describe the spread of the dress has actually been used by epidemiologists for nearly 100 years. It's used to investigate the causes and spread of infectious disease and to help develop strategies to prevent and control them. So, just like we did with the dress, we now have a population that's made up of people who are susceptible to catch a disease, people who are infectious and spreading the disease, and people who've recovered and can no longer pass on the disease. And people move from these groups. This is called an SIR model, and it's the basic infectious disease model. Just like we did with the dress, we can keep track of the number of people that are in each of these groups over time. But just like the dress, we're also ignoring a lot of realities which influence the spread of infectious diseases. And importantly, what we're doing as well is assuming that everybody in these groups has identical characteristics and behaviours. And not many diseases or populations behave quite so simply. So we often have to allow for new members to join a population, or for old members to leave. Or we have to account for the fact that for some diseases, just because you've had them, it doesn't mean that you can't have them again. And we need to add in vaccination and treatment for some diseases as well, if we really want to know how they spread through a population. So we can run virtual experiments to answer questions like, how many cases could we prevent if we had an effective vaccine against Ebola, for example? We can answer questions that we can't answer using real people. Sometimes because the type of experiments that we would need to run in a population are unethical, and at other times just because collecting the information is really just too difficult. So bear in mind that when these models were first developed 100 years ago, all the calculations would have been done by hand. So increasing computational power, though, has meant that the process of mathematically modelling infectious diseases has got much, much faster, and we can now add a lot more detail into models to try and better match what's really happening in the population. So in this era of big data, with rapid advances in science and technology, we're seeing a rapid evolution in the field of infectious disease modelling. So here's just a few of the things that are happening. We now have individual-based models which follow the history of individuals in a population and track the information that changes their chance of catching a disease. So things like their infection history, their vaccination history, the number and ages of people that they live with. People are even now using radio frequency identification tags to start collecting information on how people contact other people, how they move through a population. Because how you mix with other members of a population is very important to the spread of infectious disease. So we've gone from modelling groups of people in a population to modelling the individual characteristics and behaviours of individuals, to modelling the genomes, the genetic material of the organisms that actually cause disease, so viruses and bacteria. And we're doing that so that we can find out who patient zero was and to look at how the infection has spread through a population. And we're also using mathematics to investigate how infectious diseases, viruses and bacteria actually spread within the human body and how our immune system is fighting back. And all of this work is helping to give us a better understanding of how infectious diseases spread and how we can stop them. In my lifetime, we've seen the eradication of smallpox, and we're on track to see the eradication of polio in yours. Through careful planning, aided by the use of mathematical models, we wipe diseases that have caused millions of deaths off the face of the earth. But infectious diseases isn't the only application of mathematics to health problems. There's many biological processes that are still a mystery and lend themselves to mathematical exploration. So what questions will you answer using mathematics? Thank you.